first of all, thank you for having me here and the patience for being here since morning. I believe there have been other speakers. As introduced, I coordinate the National Association of Street Vendors of India. And if you see any Indian city or town, you will see street vendors all along. You know, so you'll see vegetable sellers, fruit sellers, food vendors, a variety of cloth sellers, variety, you know, some very interesting the things also they would be selling. And we began working with street vendors merely because we found that when India started liberalizing, globalizing, and with that urbanization increased at a great pace, so the towns started becoming important, and there was onslaught on street vendors all around. And at that time, whenever somebody became the chief minister, he or she would announce that he or she would make the city like Singapore, or that was the, I mean, mindset like Los Angeles. So never imagined of an Indian city with our own style of living, you know. So so we thought that it is necessary to change the mindset, and it's necessary to bring changes in policy which are inclusive to the street vendors. And you know, street vendors are also entrepreneurs in their own way. I mean, they, if somebody is selling fish, he or she takes the risk of buying how much, selling where, and what quantity to, what quality to buy. And so, and all along we talk about level playing field, and so since, because they are also entrepreneurs, and many you will see very many successful stories of street vendors graduating from that and becoming even big business, like Gulshan Kumar, for example, is said to be was a juice seller in Chandni Chowk area, and so street vending is a very good entrepreneurship field. But unfortunately, I mean, because of harassment, because of extortion, I can't tell you the intensity of extortion. For example, Delhi we are, so Sarojini Nagar market, if you look at Sarojini Nagar market, every week a street vendor, most of them, pays around 1,000 rupees to police and to municipality. And even to put up a small stall there, they have to pay bribe up to 5 lakhs, 6 lakhs, something like that. That would be upper end. But most vendors in most Indian cities end up paying a lot of money. So urban poor face the problem not only of income, but also of drain of income. You know, so the money which comes doesn't stay with them. So we began organizing the vendors with the hope that we will change the situation. And in 2004, we were successful in getting a national policy for street vendors. Now, as part of the policy, India being a federal state, you know, so the policy went to the states and states to the municipal bodies. As part of the policy, many state governments did make their own policies and started implementing. And some cities came up with very good solutions. Like if you are from Bhubaneswar, or have you been to Bhubaneswar, you'll see a lot of vending zones. You know, some 65 vending zones were created in Bhubaneswar. So many states came up with new ideas, like Hawker's Corner in Madhya Pradesh. They started creating Hawker's Corner. And many set up committees, judicial committees for grievance redressal. For example, Delhi set up a committee which was headed by a judge. So any street vendor who had a problem could go to that committee and get the issue addressed. But a lot of learnings were also coming in. And so we felt that if it would be a law, it would have been much better, because law is mandated and it is justifiable by a court, justiciable by a court. So they can go to the court. So we started demanding law for street vendors. And in between, you know, we have a lot of members who are food vendors. So, and then the food vendors started saying that we should have a program for them. And then somebody suggested that we should organize a street food festival, you know, because that would attract the people towards vendors and it would help us showcase our effort. So I don't know how many of you have attended in Delhi, but we organize in December a National Street Food Festival. And just to give you an example, you know, how attractive are the street vendors. You know, just in the three-day festival that we organize at Jawaharlal Nehru Stadium, like around 50,000 people come, and it's a ticketed event. You know, people pay 60 rupees just for entry to the event, you know. And And in 3 days' time, we have around 50,000 people who are visiting visiting the festival. And we also pay tax to the sales tax VAT to the government. And it provides the vendors a very good opportunity to learn entrepreneurship. You know, to it exposes them that if the presentation of food is good, then people are willing to pay even higher rates. You know, in fact, this year in the food festival, we found that 80% of the visitors were youngsters. You know, so the claim that Pizza Huts and the malls will drive away Indians from the traditional cuisine and traditional food, we found it very wrong, you know, because the presentation matters, and people are willing to pay much more. So there was a vendor from Gwalior. He was selling pav bhaji, and the price that was fixed for his pav bhaji was 60 rupees. And then he came and started quarreling with me that who is going to buy his pav bhaji at 60 rupees. I said, if you are unable to sell, you leave it, I'll buy everything. And when I met him after 2 hours, he was a happy man. He could sell his pav bhaji at 60 rupees. It was unbelievable for him. I went to Guwahati after the food festival and met the pitha seller. You know, he sells pitha in front of the Guwahati Medical College in a small stall. And he said that it was unimaginable for him to see people rushing for his pitha and praising his pitha. And he learned that, you know, his food was so tasty. And then he has started. So many, many food vendors who participated in the food festival have to permanent stores. They have the confidence now. Like there's a pizza seller from Ludhiana. Now he has opened a restaurant. There was a litti seller from Patna. He has opened 5-6 stalls after participating in the food festival. And we also took them to some international food festival in Singapore. This year we are taking them to Pakistan. We are taking them to Manila. And we collaborated with Ministry of Tourism. Now, Minister of Tourism with 55 hotel management institutes are providing training to stipend-based training to the food vendors. So we aim to transform this sector through training, through exposure, through visibility. But all along, you know, the food festival, it so happened, was able to raise the visibility of vendors. And the minister, that time Girja Vyas was the minister, when she came, inaugurated, when she met the vendors, when she saw the crowd, she was so impressed. Then we took this law issue very seriously, very aggressively. And last year in 2014, April, no, year before last, April, this street vendors law was made. Now the law, put simply, says that every city should have vending zones and no vending zones. Nobody will disagree with that. The vending zones should be decided by a town vending committee with 40% representation from street vendors. So many cities have come up with town vending committees. And in fact, these town vending committees have become multi-stakeholder bodies for decision-making regarding vending zones. And whoever gets the certificate, vending certificate, the police or any other law will not be able to interfere after the vendor gets the vending certificate. And then we have clauses like financial and then social security linkage for the vendors. So another aspect of street vending or informal workers or the working poor is that there is a lot of problem with access to financial services. So when I began working in Patna, so I found that the rate of interest at which they could access credit through the money lenders was 483.82%. You know, and unfortunately that rate remains, you know. So despite the nationalization of banks and despite all this issue, talk about financial inclusion and all the talk about Mudra bank loan, even today, you know, buying a car, you can get loan, but if you want to buy a rickshaw, if you want to buy a pushcart, you will not get loan from any other bank. So we have been linking the street vendors with the banks, and also we have also set up financial cooperatives. So there one in Delhi also we have set up the financial cooperative. Now the financial cooperative promotes saving habit, And along with promotion of saving habit, they also give loan up to 1 lakh rupees to the street vendors who are members. So that access to finance, we have been trying to solve in many of the cities. So many cities we have promoted these financial cooperatives. Bombay, for example, there was a union which was very strong, so we helped them set up a financial cooperative. Now the financial cooperative is much more strong than that union, you know, because that's the need, you know. So we talk about entrepreneurship, organization like us is very happy that we are talking about Startup India, you know. So but startup, there are many startups happening among the vendors, among people working poor, you know, but such kind of startups also need to be promoted, you know, how we include them, as we develop economy, opportunities, but these opportunities, there should be equality of opportunities, you know, how do we create that kind of equality of opportunities? And as I was saying, that level playing field important. You know, today if somebody falls ill, you know, what is the way? There is no insurance. There is no, Government of India had started a program called Rashtriya Swasth Bima Yojana. Now that program has also been abandoned, you know. So if somebody is, if there is no pension, there is no even contributory or even with government contribution. So I was talking to a professor from JNU. And he said, you know, we are becoming superpowers. We tell the world that we are superpowers. Then why can't we squeeze out money for providing social security for these kind of people who are contributing so hugely to the economy and the society of the country? That kind of mindset is needed, and that kind of policy mechanism is needed, because they are there on the streets. They are there fighting changing their quality of life. And you know, in urban scenario, many of them have to fight the mafias, many have to fight the middlemen. I remember when we had started our campaign, that time in most part of northern India, there used to be a system of middlemen, mafias. So the municipal corporation gave the right to collect taxes to these mafias, and these mafias used to collect as much money they could, you know. After, suppose I get the contract, so it would depend on my strength and the strength of the vendors, you know, how much I can collect from there. And I remember once we were having meeting in Bulandshahr, and the vendors said that they pay 80 rupees daily to the mafia. And we took this campaign very seriously, and the government of Uttar Pradesh was the first government to ban this process. So after that, there has no, and then other states followed. So we emphasize that there has to be a direct relationship between municipal corporations and the street vendors, and the street vendors need to be regulated. We all know that India is urbanizing at a great speed. By 2030, they say that there would be 600 million people living in Indian cities. But are our municipal corporations ready to take that challenge? We are seeing what's happening in Delhi, with the blame game continues. But the main issue is the municipal governance. I don't know how many of you have ever interacted with the municipal authorities, or have you ever been to a municipal corporation office. Even to pay your tax, you have to bribe. You know, that is the level of municipal bodies. And we all want to live in India. We all want to live in cities. People are migrating in large numbers. Nobody imagines a future in rural India. But are our governments, you know, local governments, willing to, ready for, with that level of governance, are they capable of handling Indian cities or governing Indian cities? I don't think so. And we have very poor mechanism of citizen participation in city administration. So now we are also taking up such kind of issues, but we remain a very membership based organization. We are a member based organization. We have around 950 affiliates from across the country, and one of our major role the major role is to change policies, laws, you know, in the favor of street vendors, so that the street vendors get security of livelihood. So many successes have happened, you know, like many cities have come up with women markets, many cities have made isolated markets, But what we are looking for is not one market here, one market there, but transformation of the entire city. You know, so that the cities are not free for all. You know, the vendors know where they have to put up their shop. You know, so that's what we are targeting. That is one. Second thing is that whenever there is a case of harassment or there case of eviction or threat of eviction, so we intervene. For example, Atta market, they have evicted the vendors. You know, the vendors were not even aware and a decision was taken. So we are trying to help them out. And along with that, we are also exploring new models of enterprise development, business development. So like this street food program has become one of our very successful program. So, and the model is that, I'll just explain you the model a little bit. So when we organize these food festivals, the vendors do not carry any risk. They just have to come there. And everything is provided by the organization, the space, the tickets, the hotel stay, and the ingredients, and from the profit, they get 60% of the profit. So there are vendors who make up to 2 lakhs in just 3 days, you know. But there are also first timers who make loss, you know. So we compensate the loss by providing them wage losses from the profit. So it is a win-win situation whereby the people also get variety from across the country. They also have fun and they also get an exposure to how the life of vendor is and what they make and what is the richness of our traditional cuisine as well as what's happening on the street. And the vendors also get an exposure to entrepreneurship and to their importance, to their worth, you know. So they feel that they have the skills, you know. So they used to get this danda from thullas and all that. So for here, you know, you have people, you know, dressed up, people lining up. So that Radha, that from Sarojini Nagar, when she put up a tea stall, she said that she couldn't believe people in suit, they are lining up and for her cup of tea, you know. So that the feeling of worth, the feeling of belongingness they get. And now we are organizing this food festival in different cities. So that kind of thing which we are trying to promote, there is also an urge and demand to enter into value chain supply of other vendors like vegetable vendors. But there are very big players in that area and we feel that we are a small organization. We don't have that kind of capital to intervene in that kind of area. But we are exploring what else in where in the value chain we can help other vendors, whether it's cloth vendors or fruit vendor or vegetable vendors. So thank you very much. Thank you.